Slackers, welcome back to another episode of the Slackcast. I'm one of your hosts, Pete Messi, here with my ever-present co-host and antagonist, Andy Brown, and a very special guest, Mr. Mike McMahon, who you may know as another member of the Political Party Crashers, our band, or if you've watched our Pockin live stream, Mike McMahon was there and brought us some very important controllers.
Or if you just move around the comment section, you may know me as... his other antagonist.
That's true. Yeah. So
I thought that was Logan.
It's gonna be a fun episode for me. No, Logan just fact checks you when you say wrong shit about Kingdom Hearts. Also me that one time. anyway. So it's our weekly podcast where some subsection of the Slack and Slash gang and I guess guests apparently get together to talk about video games, the news, and how they make us feel. So, we're going to start the show off by how we always do, by talking about what we're playing this week. So, I'm going to kick it over to our guest, Michael. What have you been playing this week?
What have I been playing this week? I've been trying to cure the massive gap in my video game playing knowledge, cache, whatever you want to call it, by making my way through the Bioshock collection on my Xbox One. And I'm at the end of the medical pavilion, and the game's already creeping me the hell out, and the diaries are super interesting, and hacking stuff's really fun. And I think I'm going to get drilled to death by Big Daddy in 3, 2, 1, go.
Yeah.
It's been fun.
That's a really fun part of the game, too. Like, I don't know about you, but I've always just found, like, medical horror to be particularly unsettling.
Oh, absolutely. So, if I have a fear, it's surgery. And so yeah. Bioshock's been a really fun game for me so far.
That's a really fun part of that game. That's cool. I'm just a level or two ahead of you. I just got to the fourth level, so I think the pavilion's the second one.
Mm-hmm. I'm not playing Bioshock Collection.
It's a mistake.
I guess I have it because I own all three games on Steam.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you get the up-reses for free and everything. I think you get the DLC too. I'm not sure how that works. I know it's that way if you buy it on the console, obviously. Is that anything else?
I'm also, I think, the only person on this couch still actively playing a lot of Pokemon Go because I'm the only person on this couch who commutes in and out of Philadelphia. So I still really enjoy Pogo. So for all of you who watch and still do, you're not alone, don't worry. It's really fun. I got a killer Vaporeon like all of us do now.
How are you liking the new updates and stuff? I haven't played in a few weeks, so I haven't like really seen how any of the like buddy system stuff ended up playing out.
The buddy system stuff is really fun for me for a lot of reasons. One, it allowed me to finally get a Blastoise that is competent at battling, and you know, both through talking to me and firsthand of your own childhood, the love that is Blastoise.
Fuck yeah. Fuck you, Andy! Shut up!
Our names will be silenced on the Slack and Slash podcast.
I'm always the water trainer minority who just gets fucking dogpiled on, so I'm glad to have an ally
today.
No more,
I'm here for
Where's
you.
Where's Thompson when you need him?
Water's the best type, Blue's the only version to play, Blastoise is the fucking best Pokemon ever made. What up?
Yeah, hell yeah.
Yes!
And the other reason the buddy system has been killer for me is because my walls are just thick enough to confuse the game. So I leave it on all night, my guy walks in circles.
That's awesome.
Niantic, if you're listening, no I don't.
That never happened. Cool. How about you, Andy?
I've also been trying to fill in some gaps. I've finally given into Mike's years of pestering. I'm playing Earthbound.
Awesome.
Glory. Awesome. Glory, hallelujah.
How's that going?
It's good. It's still very weird.
Yeah.
My favorite random interaction in any video game ever this week happened in Earthbound. Tried to open the door. Guy in the house asks me about the Beatles. Do you know the Beatles song XXX today? The answers are yes or no.
No today.
It only gets better from here.
That's so excellent.
I've also been replaying Shin Megami Tensei 4 because cool. I can't justify buying the new Shin Megami Tensei 4 yet. And it's fun.
Yeah.
I really appreciate like a good solid JRPG. And that's what it is. And every once in a while, it's fun to, like, turn up your Grimdark to 11 and just be like, I'm edgy!
Also, plug for our JRPG podcast. Annotations.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Look at you interacting with stuff that's, like, only exists in YouTube, but you're doing it in real life.
Right? I know. It's like fucking breaking the fourth wall here, getting into the fourth dimension.
Is that what's behind the fourth wall?
Yeah, the fourth dimension.
Huh.
Yeah. It's where 4D rides are. Like, they make you, like, they like glow air on your neck and stuff while you watch Shrek Fight a Dragon or something. I'm not
now
really...
Now we can do that. Now we can watch Shrek Fight a Dragon.
Yeah. If you guys at home, real quick, I'm just gonna... Did that work?
And the back of your chair just, like,
blew out some.
It's like Pete's blowing in my ear.
And now, like, all the little holes in the back of your tear are sticking out fingers. It's like, whoa!
Why did anyone think that was a good idea?
No idea. Fun fact about 4D rides. Do you remember when have you been to Disney since there was the Bug's Life one?
Yeah.
There's this Bug's Life one in Disney where...
In the tree in Animal Kingdom.
Yes, in the tree in Animal Kingdom, where at one point, the thing that happens to you...
Laura, can you come onto the camera and make that face, please?
Real quick, yeah, Andy's sister's running the camera first, and she's been sitting there ever since Mike said that, just...
So Laura knows what happens in this, apparently. What happens in this that happens to the audience, 4D experience, is you get stung by a bee. And there's this thing in the back of your seat that goes, and stings in your back!
It's horrifying.
People probably really like make them more immersed in this experience is if we sting them in the back.
That's
with a
awful.
Chair. Yeah, I had a mark on my back for the rest of my vacation. 4D.
Wow.
4D experience.
Thanks, Disney. You really made me, like, experience what it's like to live inside the Bug's Life. Fuck. Alright.
What about you, Pete? What are you playing?
So, I, too, am playing the Bioshock Collection. Like I said, I, was just playing it last night again. I had to, like, take a bit of a break from it just because we had a bunch of shoots going on in our birthday stream.
Oh, that stream.
You can also check out.
Shout out to Ultimate Chicken Horse, which I also played for the first time this week.
That game! Yeah, so actually that was a thing. We did a 12-hour live stream, which you can check out, so I played a lot of games that day. But yeah, so I just got to the level right after the Medical Pavilion. I think it's called... it's named after like a state or something like that. I can't remember right now, but it's where like you first start experiencing a lot of like automated cameras and everything, so it's like... fucking grueling. Every time I turn a corner, a fucking rocket launcher just shoots me in the face. So that's fun.
Sounds like I'll be bad at that.
Yeah, it's good. It's ridiculous. Like, you just die so fucking frequently at that push.
That'll make you really good at Overwatch, though, because you get used to it with the Torbjorn turrets and...
Beep, beep, beep.
Yeah.
Beep, beep, beep.
What we're doing is we're training you to play Overwatch with us.
Training me via Bioshock. I'm gonna be so ready to be a part of the Slack and Slash team by the time I'm done for your gamut of recommendations.
Hey, man. We're getting you all the hits, bro.
Yeah.
We're going to teach humans bad to play League at the same time.
Good lord, no.
I would pay to see that. So, beyond Bioshock, I was just telling the guys earlier, I actually finally finished my second True Pacifist run-through of Undertale last night, which was awesome. So glad I finally finished it. And, I had a lot of feelings about the game beating it the first time, but you said it earlier, like, non-jokingly, it sounds very hipsterish, but, like, you don't really beat that game until you do the True Pacifist ending, unless you're a monster, and you do the genocide playthrough, and then you're just a monster. So
you're a monster.
Yeah.
And you're a monster.
And your feelings don't matter, because you're a monster. So,
they were telling me earlier, they don't actually even want you as a subscriber if you did the genocide.
I'm just, no, that's a lie!
You can choose who to believe.
That is patently false, sir. I'll take a subscriber wherever I can get one. Click that subscribe button, home slices. beyond those two games, I'm trying to think. In the stream, I played some League with you, Overwatch, Pokemon, the same things I'm always playing. And I think that's it.
Yeah. Oh, that leaves out the other thing I was playing.
What's that?
Kirby Planet Robobot.
Oh, fuck
yeah. How is that?
You said a lot of good things about it, right?
I really, really enjoy it. It's, Kirby's been on a tear of, what are we gonna make the Kirby gimmick this time, ever since they did Nightmare in Dreamland for the Advanced?
Kirby! Nightmare in Dreamland!
Yeah,
hey, that was the best game. That's the best one.
I had a second behind Superstar, because Superstar is the shit, but tight race. But this is the first game where I felt like that gimmick super works.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's the giant robot suit thing. But what comes part and parcel with that giant robot suit isn't you're a robot instead of Kirby, it's the robot also copies powers and uses them in different ways than Kirby does.
That's cool!
Yeah, so like Sword Kirby has a sword, Sword Robot has sword arms.
That's neat.
And like Spark Robot has like these like plasma lightning balls it shoots at people. Like it's a fun way to find collectibles that weren't able to be accessed in those areas, and it actually makes you choose whether or not you want to abandon the suit in pursuit of like little medals and stuff. It just makes it more of like an exploring game.
That's
and
cool.
Honestly, it's just fun to be the shit out of stuff as a giant robot.
Is it also on the tear Kirby's been on of like these games are too easy to play as an adult?
It's less easy than Triple Deluxe was. I still would say it's easier than I want even a Kirby game to be.
Yeah. Still a little too easy.
It takes too much refuge in the space of, oh, if you want a hard version of the game, then try and 100% it and find everything. Because A, I don't think that's a good enough answer to easiness, and no. B, it's not even that hard to do that.
Yeah, giving me a checklist is not the same as giving me challenging platforming.
Right. So the platforming challenge, I would say, yeah, it's definitely still that easy. The boss battles are a little challenging.
That's good.
Do you remember the final boss from Nightmare? The Nightmare?
That yeah.
was actually a challenging boss?
Mm-hmm.
It approaches that, where it's sort of like forms of a boss you get to fight. You know, here's him in his first form, and here's...
Sure.
Like, there's a mecha DDD that turns into, like, a train on a track, and the
okay.
3D matters, because
cool.
you don't know where he is relative to you.
Uh-huh. That's cool.
Yeah, it's better. It's definitely better than...
Step in the right direction.
For sure.
Cool.
And I always like Kirby games, so take that with a little grain of salt. If you've never liked one, you're not going to suddenly start.
Right. Yeah, I'm a huge fan of Kirby stuff, too. And definitely, like, you know, I started playing them when I was a kid, so, like, I remember Nightmare and Dreamland being, not difficult, but, you know, like... Something.
An element of challenge.
Yeah, an element of challenge. But I do think boss battles specifically are a place where Kirby games have always been better. You know, mm-hmm. like, they definitely do have more solid boss battles, even if the platforming itself is a little easy.
Yeah, I think that's, they're...
Dark Souls.
Alright. No. Really, like, we have the refuge of Spaz not being here today, and...
Sorry, I also think Dark Souls is not a very good game.
But...
I just want you to know... As a viewer, you've seen what this is like. This is experience it. When you're right in the middle of like saying something relevant, he's just like, "But Dark Souls, though." Like, it's like,
I've never played Dark Souls.
Oh, Andy, I love you, buddy.
If you're a viewer of the podcast and you think, "Oh, great, even their guests hate Dark Souls," no, I don't. I just don't care. I can't be brought to care. It's not my sort of thing.
I mean, the majority of this channel loves Dark Souls. Andy and I are definitely the vocal minority in that camp.
Yeah, but emphasis on vocal, right? You're also the two that are pretty much in every single podcast.
So we are the podcast group.
You are ruling that opinion on the cast. But
he's the first member of the podcast group. He's got a coconut gun. It fires his burps. If he shoots ya, it's gonna hurt.
They're lying to you. He has no coconut gun. None. I searched the room.
P.K. Peter Kong.
That's me.
Would not play.
I wish I had a big red tie.
You wouldn't play my game, Mike?
Fuck! If we just remade Donkey Kong Country, or Donkey Kong 64, sorry, with Pete as Donkey Kong, you wouldn't
just
play that game?
You just went from, will I play it, oh, it's Donkey Kong Country, to will I play it, oh, it's Donkey Kong 64. No, probably not. That game's not very good.
It's silly.
The intro is the best part of the game, which is not a thing you really
That's
want to
fair,
say.
But the intro's iconic and one of
the
highlights
the
of the N64.
Would I rewatch the intro if you put Pete in it? Oh, yeah. No, that would be. I would figure out how to make a video of my desktop background, and that would just be what I do.
Would you play Peter Kong Country?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Which just.
Hands down.
Which just Pete as Donkey Kong.
Can it be Crunchy Kong
cartwheels.
In Tropical Freeze instead?
Sure.
Yeah, if Pete's riding on my back and has a little staff, I will definitely play that game.
I was gonna say we have to be Donkey Kong Country, and then we just have like I'm Donkey Kong and Spaz is Diddy. Just put a little hat, you know.
Ozzy can be King K. Rool.
Ozzy can be King K. Rool.
Alright, so
anyway.
I think that's we've been not talking about what we were playing for a long time. So segues to the news. We talking about the news.
Boom. What's up?
It's our news theme song.
Is that a new thing?
That's the new news theme.
Oh.
Yeah, you didn't watch the Bioshock episode because
no.
you don't want to be spoiled.
Right.
That's the new news theme.
That's the news theme?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, be hype.
I'm hype. All right, anyway, you see like the wide smile on my face, right? I'm so ready for this news. I know what it is and I'm so ready for it.
So I was thinking about it. So either after this episode, we either need to record the soundbite so we can use the news from now on, or I'm just gonna start beatboxing underneath it.
What you gotta do is one of those like those controllers that DJs have where it's just like a bunch of buttons that like, all correspond with things.
I need like one of those like synth pads.
Or
like,
Gene Belcher's keyboard would really suffice.
Yeah. Okay. So, item number one on the list. If you are an Amazon Prime subscriber, you now are also a Twitch Prime subscriber, which is cool, I guess.
A thing?
It's interesting. I don't really care about Twitch, so I can't say I'm too excited about it.
I get a free subscription every day to a channel and ad free viewing.
Yeah, it's once a month. You get one.
Every 30 days,
You get a free subscription to throw into a channel, which I'm excited about.
I'm excited to just, like, throw after I'm a subscriber or somebody. Yeah.
I'm going to give it to, shout out to Kinda Funny Games, my favorite YouTube channel. They do a live show on Twitch that I never watch because I don't watch Twitch, but yeah. I'll happily give them my $5 a month just because I have it.
I will almost definitely be giving it to any random Smash streamer who streams on Twitch because...
Mango?
No, except Mango. If Hungrybox is streaming on Twitch, then he will be getting my $5.
What about Armada?
I'm sure he
along
is.
With Who's all the greatest of my ever. Life.
Excuse me.
You and your peach boner can hide somewhere else. HBox forever.
I mean, isn't Armada, like, objectively the best ever, though?
Yeah, but is he Jigglypuff? Right, so that answers the relevant portion of the segment. Anyway.
You also get some loot in games, which is cool, but I don't play Hearthstone or Smite, which are the games they've cited as we're giving you bonuses in.
Yeah, and they said you might also get, like, you're going to get copies of games like, or play surprises like a copy of Streamline. So, like, it sounds like you're going to get free games, you're going to get items for games that are very popular on Twitch. So that's cool.
It's cool.
If you're in the Twitch ecosystem, I'm sure you're hype about this.
If you're in the Twitch ecosystem, I'm sure you're hype about it. If you're already an Amazon Prime subscriber, which, like, 95% of the people I know are.
Yeah.
And really, as a gamer, there's very few reasons not to be with their 20%, like... I swear to God, Amazon does not give your channel money.
No, seriously.
But, like, not yet. 20% off new game shit is awesome.
What up, though, Amazon? yeah, no, like, Amazon Prime, like, if you're a gamer and you don't have Amazon Prime, like...
You better have...
If you buy new games and you don't get Amazon, or have Amazon Prime, it's like...
Absolutely.
Right.
I mean, even, like, you know, not to get, like, too far down this rabbit hole, but, like, even not new games, like, if you ever look for, like, their Black Friday bundles and stuff, or anytime, like, when they did Prime Day, and everyone was like, Prime Day sucks, I'm like, well, I got a Vita for $100,
Prime Day sucks if you suck at, like, using a website to find stuff you might like. I got a loot pedal, I got so much cool shit for, like, pennies on the dot. My Xbox One was a Prime Day deal. It was $240 for two controllers, Halo 5, Rare Replay. It was nuts.
Dude, for the first Prime Day, I bought 90% of the gear we used to run Slack and Slash, a Vita, and a game.
And I bought...
And spent, like, $500.
I got the same mic you did, and it was, what, like, less than half?
Yeah.
It was, like, $60 for a $140 microphone.
Well, and the snowballs were, like, $25. Yeah. It's... Whatever.
Anyway.
This is... Hashtag not an ad.
Hashtag... you probably have Amazon Prime.
Right. So,
Amazon is going to be running America in 20 years.
Please. So, in addition to the free subscription every 30 days, you also get ad-free viewing, which is pretty cool.
Yeah.
So, like, for me, like, as someone who doesn't really watch Twitch, the few times I do, the ads are a big part of why I don't like the Twitch experience. So, if I can get on Twitch, not see ads, and close the chat, maybe I'll actually use Twitch a little bit more.
You get exclusive emotes.
You do?
Oh,
shit, you do get. And more chat colors, and you get to crown yourself with the chat badge of royalty. Oh, I don't care about those things, but you might.
Twitch Plays Pokemon takes off again, I can't wait.
Twitch Plays Pokemon Snap, let's do it, guys. Okay, so...
Twitch Plays Fire Emblem.
Do it.
That's gotta exist already.
Twitch doesn't succeed.
Twitch doesn't succeed. Alternate name for that series. Everyone dies and they wipe.
So, next on our news list, League Worlds are happening.
Yep,
that's really it.
Yeah.
It's like the first games of group stages are happening, so it's not like they're in the, oh man, SKT T1's going to win Worlds for the third year in a row, I think.
Yeah, no one's even, like, been eliminated yet, I don't think.
Nope.
At the time of this recording.
Our boy CLG had a great first game of the tournament.
Yeah, fucking shout out on CLG. We watched that game and they fucking just, oh my god, they dunked on him. It was awesome. It was especially because, like, I remember there was, like, G2 got that first blood, and it was kind of like, uh-oh, CLG's not looking so hot, and then they just fucking avalanched.
Like, CLG's teamfights, man.
Yeah.
Aframu is the best support in the world.
Aframu's the fucking best support in the game, saying it right here. Like, that guy is a player, a true player. He's the kind of player that makes me proud to main support, because he's so fucking good. His Nami plays are out of this world.
Mike looks confused.
Sports.
As someone who thoroughly enjoys regular sports, I just like hearing people be this happy about sports.
About competition.
Like, this is just cool. I don't get it, but whatever. Sounds great, guys.
League Worlds are cool,
awesome.
Man.
League Worlds are cool. You should check them out.
I probably will.
We should honestly...
I didn't used to pay attention to any of it, and then I got super down the competitive Smash rabbit hole, and now I watch Melee tournaments all the fucking time, so I'm sure I would really
competitive like Pokemon it. Is fun to watch, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Especially, the actual, sanctioned stuff, the doubles.
The Worlds, yeah.
What was that, a year or two ago, where that dude bought in a Pachirisu?
Last year.
And was like, what?
Yeah.
What? I thought that guy was trolling hard, and he wiped with it.
I think his name's Sun Jung Pak. Yeah, he's a fucking competitor. And the guy who won this year...
And an innovator, that was... Yeah. It wasn't just, who's tried and true strategy.
That wasn't meta at all.
No, he brought that shit there.
Yeah.
It was... Yeah, no, it... I'm not smiling mockingly. I just don't know what the words they're saying mean.
Oh, yeah.
But, it sounds... Awesome. It really does.
I would strongly recommend checking it out. The commentary guys, they have Jat and Freak, because it's still the internet, so we still get to make up our own silly names.
I still like that about Pro League.
Wait a minute. You watch football. There are people named Moose and Goose. I don't think it has anything to do with the internet. At a certain point, if I can't see your face and hear your voice, you can call yourself whatever you want.
I particularly like it because... it reminds me of, if pro sports was, mixed with hip-hop culture, where it's everyone just has a really weird nickname that kind of tells you a good amount about their personality.
I do like that. I do like that a
lot.
One
of my favorite players, shout out to Dignitas, who we're going to talk about in a couple minutes, back in 2014 when they were, a good team, their ADC's name was I'm a Cutie Pie, and he was, an overweight, shaggy Hispanic guy who was just a huge, goofy, smiley, chummy guy, and just, perfect. You know? I don't know. I love that aspect of it. It's so fucking silly.
It's so fucking silly. It's just, I can never match names to faces.
Yeah.
Anyway, what I was gonna say is their commentary, team is really good at explaining what's going on and, why you need to do this thing. And there's a little bit of an assumption that you play, at least on some level.
Yeah.
But you can figure it out pretty quick if you, suffer through a couple games.
Context is context.
This year...
If I watch people doing well and bad and hear the tone of the commentators, I'll probably catch on.
I think this year also they've done a few things. They might not be brand new this year because, admittedly, I haven't watched LCS since Worlds last year.
Mm-hmm.
But when I watched the first game, they started doing instant replays, which is something they never did before.
That'll help.
And, they slow-mo it and explain what's happening. And I feel like if you're someone who doesn't play the game, that's the kind of stuff that's going to... make you understand what the where you're supposed to be looking, you know?
And that's what 90% of sports.
Of any sport.
Where you're supposed to be looking.
Yeah, it's who am I supposed to be looking at right now? Don't follow the ball, follow the player you're supposed to be looking at right now, you know? It's very much like that. I was just thinking about it, we should totally do a video where we just watch Worlds and record us watching Worlds and try to explain things to Mike as they happen. I think that'd be fun. You down to do that?
Yeah, why not?
We should do that.
Yeah.
I'd like that tutorial anyway.
Yeah. So, yeah. Okay. All right, cool. So, episode 3, Jesus Christ. Sorry. Item number 3 on the list. Nidhogg is getting a sequel titled Nidhogg 2. It's coming... Oh, did they give a date on that?
No.
Next, 2017, right?
No, it's coming.
It's coming 2017, and there's a trailer. It's a 16-bit style. Everything Nidhogg. There's, new weapons. You can get axes and spears and bows and stuff.
It looks fun, it's just
looks awesome.
It looks weird and unsettling, but if the gameplay's still there, I'll still play it.
Oh, totally. It's not, off-putting the way it looks.
Yeah, it's just, a little off-putting.
Yeah, Nidhogg had a very sleek style, and these characters are, kind of chubby. They have, weird bug eyes and stuff. I think, you made the comparison. It's, it looks like the first game was made on the Atari, and this one was made on the Super Nintendo.
Yeah.
And it's weird. Still excited. Nidhogg is, I love that game. It's one of my favorite multiplayer games of the last couple of years. Check out our Let's Play on it.
Okay.
God, my fucking brand synergy today.
Oh, yeah. Look at you. All right, so moving forward, they put out some trailers for Dishonored 2.
And they look great.
They do look so cool.
They look... I really like how they did it, too.
Yeah.
They did, a run-through of one of the levels, but they did a low-chaos and high-chaos version.
Yeah.
And I can't wait to play as Emily. Shit looks dope.
Oh, my God, yes. It's I just... I'm really excited to see, how that character has evolved over the, 20, 30 years between the two games and everything. But also just, I said this before, her powers are all just so reminiscent of the darkness, and I just love it. All of her powers are just, let me just, turn into a weird shadow monster and, crawl around the floor or some shit, and I'm just, Jackie! So cool. Can't wait. Check out both of them. They're really cool. As always, the new thing we're doing on the show is any of the news links we talk about will be annotated below. You can get them in the description. So if you want to go check out those trailers, do it, please. They both look great. I mean, we've talked about this game ad nauseum. So.
Oh, yeah. But Mike, who didn't play the first one, You like those trailers, right? You thought it looked cool?
I went from looking at those trailers to looking up prices for the first game, was how interested I was in them.
Yeah.
And not just on gameplay, really on aesthetic, too. I thought it was really a beautiful-looking game. There's this cinematic sort of... Not cinematic. There's this sort of, like, automatic sequence in both of them with, like, a roller coaster cart moving its way up the house thing.
Yeah.
And just the changes in lighting as it's going up, it feels very... It does its rustic setting really well.
Yes.
I was very interested in the visuals as well as the gameplay, which looks so cool.
Yeah,
and the arsenal at your disposal, just it looks so much fun to play around with.
The toy box.
Yeah.
Oh my god. Yeah, shout out to Arkane. Their art direction is really good. And I think it's interesting that you said the rustic setting. Mm-hmm. It's because the first game is entirely set in a grimy, dark, urban kind of like steampunk.
Well-punk. Definitely not London.
Yeah. Oh, please. It's just like, it's like if everyone in London during the Industrial Revolution got the plague. And, like, that's that first game. So, like...
No, this looked like seaside Italy at
yeah,
sunset.
Yeah, and it's, like, it beautiful. Gorgeous. Like, it's bright. There's, like, a nice sunset. Like, everyone looks healthy.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, wow, all right, cool. Like, shout out to Arkane. I'm really excited to see what they did for Dishonored 2. Dishonored is one of my favorite games. I was saying before, like, the only reason it didn't get an honorable mention in the Seven Faves game show is because I named 10 games, so...
Dishonored's number 11. My
yeah.
favorite game.
Yeah, it really is. Honestly, I love Dishonored.
Pete's 11th favorite game of all time.
Pete's 11th favorite game of seven.
So yeah, obviously no higher praise I can give a game than to say it's my 11th favorite game of all time. Yeah, please. So if you haven't checked out Dishonored, check out the Dishonored collection. It's really a solid game, and Dishonored 2 looks like it's going... It looks like it won't disappoint. So, item number 5 on the list is, there's an updated list of PSVR launch titles, which is, like, right around the corner. We're a couple weeks out from that, which is really exciting. You can go to IGN.com, and like I said, I'll have the link in the description below, and there's just a list of all the games that are going to be available at launch for PSVR. Let us know which ones you want us to pick up, because if you're a regular viewer of the show, you'll know that I already have a pre-order in place for PSVR, so any games that you want to see us make videos on, you can curate that list early, and I'll make sure to pick them up.
Watch Andy vomit from being disoriented by Eagle Flight.
I really hope that happens.
Watch me knock over all the stuff Pete owns. I do that without a VR headset on. I'm probably going to destroy the set of this show.
Dude, VR headsets. I'm so excited. Like, we've talked about it a little bit on the show, but, like, I'm a very heavy believer in VR. Like, I definitely think that this first generation is, like, the proving ground tech, so obviously it's not going to be... You know, like, it's probably not exactly consumer-ready yet, but it is enthusiast-ready.
You were into Warehouse Robots, right? That was one of the games Casey brought over for his Oculus that you, like, you fight robots in a warehouse.
Oh,
yeah.
Raw Data is the name of the game. Yeah, I was like, what? Yeah, no, that game was amazing. I still haven't gotten the video edited for it yet, just because editing VR stuff is weird. But, yeah, Ozzy and I both played this game, Raw Data, and actually, it's funny because... My experience with the game, like, I was already a believer in VR. That was one where I was like, wow, it's actually a little further along than I thought it would be.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember the moment that was most interesting to me was Ozzy was playing before I had a chance to play. And he's playing Casey, all of a sudden is like, oh, hey, like, you can crouch to duck and, like, do these other things. And, like, all of a sudden, like Ozzy was, like, you know, like, ducking behind stuff. And, like, he turned around and saw something and got scared and fell over. And, like, those are the moments where I'm just like, wow. You know, it's like, this is really interesting technology.
See, those are the moments where I'm like, wow, I'm going to need its own room for this thing.
Oh, yeah.
Or, like, there goes all the stuff I own.
It's a very realistic
problem.
Probably
my bones.
That's only for the Vive, though. So PSVR, like, you don't move. You just play it, sit down. So that one you could probably manage without breaking things.
We'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see.
It's all motion controls in your controller.
I don't know that I want to bring it to my home. Just from the Wii, my wife punched me in the face playing baseball, so I don't know how this is gonna go.
I mean, let's be real, Sam should probably never use VR, but
true.
Just and not implying she's dumb. She's actually literally training to be a brain surgeon.
She's the smartest person that I think any of us know in her field. And then she gets outside of her field and punches me in the face with a Wii remote. So, you know.
She didn't use the wrist straps, dude!
She did! She did use the wrist straps! She used the wrist straps 3 inches from my face and went like this with a fake bat.
Oh, jeez.
As you can see, I got over it in the 6 years since this happened.
Sure, clearly.
Stuff right there.
Alright, so these are our last two bits of news.
We really should have like put the esports stuff next to this.
Yeah, we really should have. We ordered this all one. Alright. Apologies. Yeah. So, in other League of Legends news, the 76ers have bought both Dignitas and Apex, who are, if you're not familiar with the LCS, they're both competitive gaming organizations. They have League of Legends teams. Dignitas specifically has teams in several other games that you can look up on your own time.
And this means that the 76ers will win more esports games than basketball games this year.
I'm sure if you watch sports,
Ben Simmons, come back.
The fucking big highlights of it are essentially that they've bought both of these teams. They are going to be merging the two of them. Apex is no longer a team and will now be playing underneath the Dignitas banner. And they've assumed all of control of all of Dignitas.
Really cool. Just like Dig is such a storied franchise in the LCS and the just turn to shit they've done the last 2 years.
It's been really heartbreaking.
It's like they got relegated, and now all of a sudden it's like, oh, Dig's back in the LCS and is a decent team. Like, Apex were pretty good this year.
So I'm really excited for this move. I'm excited to see a team that
I want
to
see the Sixers coax Cutie Pie out of retirement.
That would be awesome. I would be so happy to see him come back. Pull back some of the other talent that's still in the game. See if they can get back some rough
just
approximation of it.
The all-star.
So, Dig, and again, I'm catching up on Dig stuff, was a team that has a storied history, storied franchise.
Yeah, they've been around for what?
And have been bad the last 2 years.
Yes.
And are about to be good again?
Yes.
The 76ers.
And the 76ers bought them?
Yes.
Okay. If you somehow are the very small bit of the audience that I'm the only one, aren't I?
I guess Logan, maybe.
Logan, you probably understand this. The Sixers and Dig are the same thing, so this is kind of really awesome accidental synergy going on.
It is
going to be fun to watch them both get good at the same time.
So I have a brief quote here I wanted to share with you guys from CEO of the 76ers, Scott O'Neill, who, quote, said, "We were smart enough to know what we didn't know." So they brought on Greg Richardson, who's an executive who has been in consumer tech and video gaming, and he's kind of overseeing this project. And they made it very clear that there's going to be some brand synergy between the teams, but they're basically going to be two separate entities. You're not going to have to see 76ers stuff at Dig Games or whatever.
You should.
Yeah, maybe, right? I don't know. That'd be cool.
Joel Embiid shows up and plays some league and nobody understands what I'm talking. Go ahead.
So the other half of the quote is, quote, "The market created itself and became a product that 250 million people are watching. And when they watch, they're watching an hour and a half a day. But at the same time, it's an incredibly large, immature market that is somewhat of a wild west." I think it's interesting to see more established businesses kind of getting their hands in this pot. And I think it definitely helps the legitimacy of esports. It's going to help the income of esports. I think in a lot of ways, this could be really positive for the people that enjoy the sport or the esports and people who, that made me sound like a 90-year-old man, and people who play them as well.
I'm really excited about it, particularly as it pertains to the fact that it's the 76ers getting involved, too, because like you said, it's a more experienced business entity getting their feet wet. But on top of that, it's an entity that's faced the challenges of sort of keeping the interests of a fan base during times of waning talent, not being that good, and I don't know. I think it's really particularly good experience, well tailored experience to sort of the challenge of growing esports followings and getting people invested, not just in esports generally, but in following a team
and fixing this team.
Yeah. I think it will be. I'm really interested as a fan of. A new fan of esports and a longtime fan of sports to see how this marriage of things goes. It's really cool to see that this is happening at all.
I agree. I also think it makes sense for them to make a bigger, I think it makes sense for traditional sports media to make some sort of play on esports, because I definitely think that they are separate things, but there is crossover there. There are people who lots of people that you guys.
There's two out of three of this couch is the crossover.
Yeah.
Andy and I are going to spend probably 14 hours watching football tomorrow. You know what I mean?
Right, exactly. And it makes sense that those same people who also enjoy video games would enjoy esports. And we've said it before, the broadcast stuff is it's obviously esports. I think the reason they use the moniker esports is a lot of ways because so much of the organization of the competition.
Borrowed from sports.
Yeah, like, just, and straight up copy-pasted.
Yep.
Like, shoutcasters, you know, like, all that stuff. It's exactly like watching.
You said earlier, league's now doing instant replays.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's just, let's borrow from a tried-and-true formula and make it work. And watching people at the highest level, anything, compete against each other, it just is what it is. You know, like, I'm a football fan, first and foremost. You know, anything fan, almost as much, you know?
Yeah.
I can't tell you a whole lot about hockey, but I will sit down and watch top-tier hockey teams play. It's just fun to watch people who are the best at their shit compete against each other.
So why do you watch the 76ers?
hey, sometimes it's fun.
I am also a Sixers fan.
It's fun to root for the underdog, dude.
We almost beat the Rockets when we saw them. It was a competitive game.
We're gonna
be good
this year, maybe?
We were, and then another foot broke in half. Let's not.
Yeah, so, moving on to more sports and esports news. So,
more basketball and LCS news.
Weirdly specific. So, I think it was like about a week later. Magic,
it's like 2 days later.
Magic Johnson and Friends, which is, I'm just using Magic Johnson because it's funny. But, like, basically a team of entrepreneurs, sports people, media people came together and, like, created a coalition that acquired Team Liquid. So, you can check the link below to get, like, the full explanation. It's pretty complicated, actually, how many people are involved, but here's the quote that they offered. Quote, Team Liquid, one of the most successful global esports team franchises, has announced the sale of the controlling interest in their team to a diversified and accomplished ownership group, led by two renowned professional sports team owners, media and technology entrepreneurs Peter Guber and Ted Leonsis? Leonsis? Whatever.
Leonidas.
Leonidas. Steve Arkanek and more people. Will continue their... Oh, these are the guys who are already there. Will continue their respective roles as co-CEOs of Team Liquid and will also serve as directors for Team Liquid. Boy, so there's, like I said, there's a lot more shit here that's going to just explain how the leadership is breaking down, which you can check out if you're interested in. The meat and potatoes here is that, basically, the leadership that's still there is going to stay in charge and will continue in some kind of executive role, and that the rest of these people are going to be basically brought on to help build the organization and grow it. So that's another thing where it just sounds like a good move. It sounds like they're not going to try to oust the people that have built this successful franchise. They're just going to bring in people that have more experience than them and try to make it bigger. And that's great.
Yeah.
I mean, like, good. Like, the more, the more we see stuff like this, I think, the better it's going to be for esports, so...
For sure. You know, with the last year of ESPN starting to get into, albeit sort of not knowing what they're doing quite yet, covering sports.
They're trying.
They are. They definitely are. Some of the stuff we sourced for this video, you nabbed from their coverage of it. So they're definitely getting better. But just this continuous wave of making these things in tandem rather than the sort of contentious relationship and ridiculously unnecessary contentious relationship that has existed between fans of sports and fans of esports. It doesn't make any sense, you know. It's nice to see this growing.
It's a needless culture clash.
Absolutely.
And it's nice to see this, absolutely. And it's nice to see so many people from traditional sports media kind of, like, come out and say that and be like, this is just a new form of competition. It's like, it's not sports, but it's also not invalid.
Right.
So, like,
it's also really funny to see people from traditional sports media who clearly have no idea what they're talking about do esports reporting.
Yeah, like,
I don't know if you saw ESPN's, like, relatively recent article on the You Ain't Falco Wombo combo video that's still a prevalent Smash meme.
It was
so just like...
It was delightfully uninformed. It was just so...
I hadn't read this.
It was like... it was a lot like the first two, like, 3 days of when Pokemon Go exploded, and for some reason there were weathermen talking about it on morning shows. It was just like... The level of, we don't know what we're
just
doing.
Just like, my boss said, talk about esports, you ain't Falco.
Real quick, I want to give a specific shout out to the Daily Dots esports desk. They do, I think, some of the best esports coverage in the game. They've been doing the classic sports coverage of esports, like, longer than pretty much anybody else, so check them out if you're interested in getting a more in-depth look. But I will say, like, yeah, definite big ups to ESPN for trying to get ahead of it and not being dismissive or any of those things, like, trying to legitimize it but not make it sports and not... You know, make it like this separate thing that's like totally marginalized either.
Yeah, of course the cynical reply to that is, well, of course they didn't do that. You know, there's money to be had. Yep. But there's money to be had in culture wars, too. You know, they just as easily could have tried to monetize the competition against this new wave of shit.
Absolutely.
They didn't go that route. And it's nice to see that while that conversation annoyingly still exists amongst fans, you really don't see it at the higher level.
The professional level. Yeah.
And honestly, just as a little side note on this, I love specifically that it's Magic Johnson, because, you know, sports figures are divisive personalities. You know, Johnson was a Laker, so Celtics fans have plenty of ill will towards him.
Right.
But Magic Johnson specifically, we're not talking about Kobe Bryant. We're not talking about Tom Brady. We're not talking about a sports figure where that's, like, hated. He's such a goofy and, like, pleasant person.
Yeah.
This is only ever going to go over well that Magic Johnson does something.
I feel that same way about, like, when... Who is it that Shaq picked up?
Energy.
Energy, where it's, like, Shaq is a similar where it's, like, he's one of those... He's one of those sports icons that kind of eclipses that, you know? Like,
he's so ubiquitous. You're talking about Shaq not just as a basketball player for the Lakers, but as the guy who advertises Gold Bond by shimmying, you know? It's like nobody has really, like, sitting at home fuming about Shaquille O'Neal's opinion on anything. Yeah. So, it's a nice group of people to see foray in this.
I think the best, my favorite basketball player owning a professional league team thing is Rick Fox. Bought a team to connect with his son who's into video games and then named it Echo Fox.
Awesome. So awesome.
And they're pretty good.
that's the best part.
Okay, so as much as I've really appreciated this, like, we honestly probably could have made, like, esports and sports the meat and potatoes
esports
of the
and
show.
Basketball.
But we talked about that a ton, and that was awesome, but now I'm gonna uneloquently segue us to the meat and potatoes topic of the show.
You've done this so gracefully before, Pete. What happened?
Ah, whatever. It's fucking...
You know what the real shame of it is? At the top of the Magic Johnson bit, you said meat and potatoes.
I did,
and
yeah.
And I was like, oh man, if we could make this short, we could just flip. No.
No.
Didn't happen.
But yeah, we started talking about fucking Toby Fox or
thanks,
whatever.
Laura.
Fucking, not Toby Fox. We're gonna talk about Toby Fox.
Yes, that's the segue! Boom!
We're gonna talk about
music and video games!
Okay, so yeah, we decided to have our buddy Mike on the show because not only were we talking a bunch about sports and esports, we're gonna be talking about video game music today. We're not only gonna talk about, like, video game specific music, but that's probably gonna be the focus of the conversation. So where do you guys wanna start? Do you wanna get soundtrack, like, jukebox stuff out of the way so we can focus on the heavy stuff? Or what do you think?
I would rather make sure we give the upfront space to this, to the stuff we're really
that's good. Sounds good.
Yeah.
So, because we brought up Toby Fox, and the reason I proposed this topic today is we found a link to the Undertale soundtrack on vinyl. All of us bought the Undertale soundtrack on vinyl.
Yeah.
Can't wait.
Yeah, oh my god.
Can't wait.
And it's a dual disc, and I would not be more excited about that.
It's awesome. The music's awesome, and vinyl's awesome, and I'm so happy.
Also, in that same vein, before we get really deep into, like, talking about Undertale's music, shout-outs to one of my favorite YouTubers, Ace Waters, who has a excellent Undertale covers record that we were listening to while we were watching the first game of Worlds.
Yeah, Andy put that on for us last night. It was
good.
Really cool.
Yeah,
really cool.
Ace Waters is a really talented musician.
Clearly.
He's very interesting. So check him out. He's great. I'll fucking throw a link to him in the description as well. So, yeah, Toby Fox, man. Undertale's music is really special.
Undertale's music is a big part of Undertale's charm.
I agree.
Undertale's music might be... It's one of the motivating factors in wanting to say that that game is, like, one of the better singular visions I've ever... You know, because, like, it's his game and it's his music. It's just such a...
Oh, yeah.
Like, a delightfully combined work as a result of that fact.
I mean, I definitely think that, like, him being so involved in... Like, if you actually, like, look at the credits of Undertale, there are only 4 people that are credited frequently at all, and only 2 of them are, like, really frequently credited,
mm-hmm.
and it's Toby and then Temmie Chang, who's one of the additional artists. If you've played the game, you recognize Temmie, named for her. Sorry, I'm going to plug one more thing. Go check out her, on her YouTube channel, she has her senior thesis project, which is an excellent animation. I think it's called Potion Shop. I'll link it in the bottom below. Fucking excellent. It has the Surisu from Avi and Surisu, who work on Steven Universe.
Mm-hmm.
He did the music for it, and Toby did some of the composition.
Cool.
It's fucking awesome. So that's really great.
Well, the music.
But yeah, the music. So I am totally in agreement there, where him having such a it is so cohesive because he was so instrumental in all these parts that, like, the music for every moment feels perfect. and like every single thing has its own theme.
There's like large sections of Undertale that only work because of the music.
Yeah, that set up like the atmosphere.
What do you have in mind in particular?
The just walking through the city at the end.
Yeah. Walk through the house.
Yeah,
while
the
Undertale
house,
theme plays.
While the Undertale theme plays, or just like any time the game really wants to like make you feel lonely. The music does 90% of lifting there, and I know that like it's easy to say, oh, you know, they're using music to just like do the work, but like the game does it too.
Yeah,
and the music just makes what the game could be going for. Like, you can play Undertale without the sound on, it's still a really good experience.
Yeah,
but like the music makes it so much better.
It's significantly lessened, I think.
Yeah, you're missing out.
And I think that's like, that's true, because not only are there moments like that that are sold by, like, the atmosphere is in a lot of ways built by the sound. I also think that specifically in regards to, like, the boss characters, how, like, each of them has their own theme that is very indicative of, like, how you're kind of supposed to feel about them, you know? Like Papyrus's is, like, very silly, you know? And it's, like, it's lackadaisical. It's not, like, this isn't a serious, threatening battle, you know? You don't have anything to lose. Even if he beats you, he doesn't kill you like every other boss does, you know? And
he's like, oh, fight me again!
Yeah.
You clearly weren't trying.
Right. And, like, that's, you know, that matters. And, like, the fact that, like, you have, like, Metaton, who has this, like, very robotic soundtrack that evolves as his form shape and stuff like that. Like, there's just, it's very good at setting a scene, and I think like part of that is obviously like the artistic presentation, but like the music does like you said, I think a lot of the heavy lifting, and that comes from like choice of instruments and stuff too. Like we were talking a little bit about voicing before we got the show going, and it does a really good job of mixing kind of classic chipset sounds with like modern instrumentation, and it simultaneously feels old but new, and that's kind of Undertale's shtick.
And that's a point I want to make before we get away from Undertale specifically, is we've got a short list prepared here of things we want to talk about, and Undertale is uniquely recent amongst our examples, and I think it's because of what you just said, their ability to mix newer and older conventions, but it's also just really impressive that it... Earthbound does a really good job of turning a lot of gaming conventions on its head, and that does not stop short at its music, which often, again, is either, it sounds like music you, the guy playing it, would have come up with, not the guy making the game would have come up with, or you're just, the music sounds tired of what you're doing when you feel like you should be past this area by now. And in other moments where it does tighten up and get, like, serious, there's a lot of empty space, and it just sort of leaves you with the moment you're dealing with. And it feels, in a game that gets a lot of its weight from levity, like, if I can say that without being ridiculous, when it finally does tighten up and get serious, the fact that the music is no longer so bouncy and silly makes you realize that, oh, you thought you were in danger before, but, like, now you're way outside of your comfort zone. Right. Like, those towns were scary, but they were still towns. Where are you now?
Yeah.
And the music does just a great job of making you feel alienated from the not just the sights of the world and the power of the things around you in the world you were in before, but the sound of the place that you're in now. The very last area of Earthbound, it's not really soundtrack so much as sound design, has like the clanking of the boots of the little metal suits you're in against very sparse soundtrack, and it just feels so alone in a game that, again, you felt like you were in danger before, but it's just sort of like you didn't know what you were heading towards.
Mm-hmm.
And it, I don't know, I love that about that game.
I think like, I don't know, I really do think that like good sound design is something that's so important to, especially early games, which is why I think, like, we have this unifying theme of liking a lot of these early composers, is because, like, when you have a more simple palette, you know, where you have to evoke emotion through, you know, like, again, like, through, like, simple sprites and, you know, simple art, and, like, music does a really huge job in setting that scene. And I think, like, that idea you have of, like, that even both of you have touched on of, like, having that kind of light, you know, even, like, simple melody usually in the beginning of the game, and as you progress, like, Pokemon does a really good job of that. Real quick, before we move on from Earthbound, I did want to give a shout-out to the composer, who I know we'll come back to, but Hirozaku Hip Tanaka. Shoutouts to you.
He's the man. And also, before we get away from Earthbound, just the last specific example that I can't keep myself from bringing up. Two of the last areas, one of them is this big, empty, scary swamp. And then the next to last area, sorry if I'm spoiling things for you guys, but being there is way more interesting than just hearing me call it a thing, is this, prehistoric area where there are dinosaurs roaming around. They're both terrifying, but the music in the first one is creepy as you're wading through a swamp, and the music in the second one can't, help but restrain itself from wonder. Like, it's scary, but it's also, scary and inspired, you know? Like, the first time, you're a kid in a swamp, so you're just scared. The second time, you're a kid in a prehistoric area, so it's intense, but it's also, filled with this sense of, holy shit, look at these fucking dinosaurs, man. Like, it's geeked out and intense, you know? It just, it gets at the player perspective on the game just so well. So definitely a shout-out to Tanaka, because that is really some impressive shit.
Also, I know we're talking about, older games, but, sound design. I also want to give a shout-out to, I don't know who composed it, and I can't think of any specific melodies, but I really love the soundtrack to Mass Effect.
Yeah, Mass Effect soundtrack is
Mass
really
Effect
good.
Soundtrack is, really, it feels chrome.
Yeah.
Which I appreciate in Mass Effect, which is a game about, a shiny vision of the future.
Right. Yeah, that's a good point. I think, one of the modern games I'd like to give a shout-out to is, I think, it's not, consistently great, but specifically the Uncharted theme for Uncharted is really good. That, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It just, nails that, very,
That does sound Uncharted.
It does, you know? It nails that, Indiana Jones pulpy vibe, you know? And I think, too few games nail that kind of atmosphere that we're talking about with these older games, you know. I do really think that that point you brought up about Undertale is true for specifically a lot of Nintendo franchises, where Mario music feels like Mario music. It's kind of jazzy, but it also has a slight gypsy vibe to it sometimes. Yep. You know, yep. Kirby music is very bouncy. It uses a lot of triangle waveforms, which, unless you make synth music, that doesn't mean anything to you.
But, also just a lot of very, very quickly moving staccato parts.
Yeah.
You know, it's it's just, it makes sense with the fact that there's a block moving there, and you're moving this thing, and something's flying at your face, and, none of it's particularly dangerous, but it's all very bright, shiny, and hectic, and silly, and in a way that even other Nintendo games aren't.
And even the stuff that's dark, if you think of, the Halberd theme, you know, it's still very quick moving, it's a very quick tempo. Shout out to Jun Ishikawa for the Kirby soundtrack. We'll probably talk a little bit more about that. But something I was trying to say before, the point you're making about, the idea of, a building, right, building towards something, I think Junichi Mashuda does a really good job of that, specifically in the first set of Pokemon games. And I'm sad to say, I feel like it's true of both Pokemon's art and music that, as it's gone on, it's just become increasingly more generic.
I want to push back on music just a little bit, because I think Gen 6 did an awesome, awesome job of taking inspiration from French folk music to make a Pokemon soundtrack that really embodied its French-inspired landscape.
Yeah.
It's still not quite the epic, and it doesn't do what you're currently talking about, the leading up to things, nearly as well. And part of me wonders, I'm so glad this is what we're talking about, part of me wonders that if that's because they peaked a little early, because my favorite single track in video games is the Champion Battle from Pokemon Blue.
Yeah, you're talking about.
Nothing has ever felt so dire as the little just totally dissonant notes all over the place.
It's so tense.
That just lead-in of just crescendoing nonsense that just stops and goes to da-da, da-da, da-da. And then it gets crazy again. It's I know that that's describing almost nothing, but I also doubt that many people watching this haven't finished Pokemon Blue. So
if you're not familiar,
you have to.
Yeah, if you're not, you'll get there eventually. If you're not familiar with these tracks, go listen to them.
If you're not familiar with these tracks, keep up with Pete Plays Pokemon Blue, because you will get there. But no, it
segues.
It's man, it leads and leads and leads. It's a game where you've got wild Pokemon battles that have some sort of, you know, there's a struggle, right? You've run into wild Pokemon, you've got a battle, and maybe you'll catch it, but, it doesn't feel like it's got that much weight. Trainer battles, a little bit more weight, depending on the kind of trainer you're fighting.
Gym battles. Even more so. Elite Four battles, even more so. And then it peaks at that. It's just so... It does such a good job getting you there that, like, you almost expect something epic's going to happen when that last dialogue box goes away. And
I
it
totally
does.
Agree.
It does.
And I think, you know, to, like, talk about, like, the ramp of that, if you contrast that with the first melody that you hear in Pallet Town, you know, it's so simple and, like, so, like, just, like, jovial and kind of bouncy and... You know, like, even the Route 1 music that...
The Pallet Town music you're currently talking about, by the way, viewers at home, that was the processional music at my wedding.
It was.
I fucking love that track.
Mike wrote an arrangement for a string quartet for
it's
it.
It's just such a pretty little pastoral piece, and, like, I got so exhausted looking through all these old, like, pastoral classical pieces. I was like, nah, we'll go with Pallet Town.
It worked,
it's
man.
Delightful.
It was lovely.
It
oh,
is
yeah.
a great place to start.
Yeah, man, and I think that is what does it for me, too, because it not only is it a good ramp, it does a really good job of... In a way that I think a lot of other, like, Pokemon games haven't done quite as well, either, and I wonder how much of this has to do with music. But just that, like, I feel like each part of the first set of games, like, feels a little bit more segmented. Not in so that the world doesn't feel cohesive, but each feels more distinct. It doesn't just feel like the next town that I'm going to fight a gym leader and move on from.
Do you know where I really noticed that in the first Pokemon games? Is Vermilion. It's a port town, and that da 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 da.
Yeah.
It's like you expect there to be a cruise ship somewhere in this town. You know, it's yes. like this is a port town. I've arrived at the port town of this continent.
Right.
You know?
Absolutely.
It's not I've arrived at the town with the electric gym leader, probably. I don't know. Let's go find out.
Right. Yeah. And I think, like, they only reuse a town theme, like, once or twice. Like, I know Pewter and Viridian have the same, but they're very similar.
And they're adjacent.
Yeah.
And it's the first and last gym. Like, there's a lot of ways you could make that a thing that works. But, oh, man, we got this far in talking about Pokemon games and didn't talk about the Lavender Town music, which is the creepiest shit on the earth.
Well,
that's
funny.
Why I was avoiding talking about it.
I was about to...
give me nightmares.
I was about to bring that up, because I think that and the Viridian Forest both use super fucking weird and eerie themes that are, like... that similar use of dissonance and, like, just creepiness that's there.
Oh, yeah.
And, by the way, viewers of the podcast, if you have a significant other with whom you occasionally wake up in the same place, don't make the Viridian forest music your alarm clock tone. She will not thank you for it.
Wop, 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 wop.
She's not a fan of that at all, actually.
Oh, man.
Just word of the wise, things I've learned.
Good, that's pro marriage tips here with Mike McMahon. I think that excellent mix that we're talking about, like, of good, light, jovial kind of tracks, but then sets that really set the scene when things are supposed to feel epic or dire or whatever, is such a important distinction and one that those three series we've touched on nail really well.
To go back to those three series and the thing that Mike said about, like, the end of Earthbound and, like, the sound design,
mm-hmm.
I think that a really powerful thing in music and sound design everywhere is silence, and being able, like, having a really strong soundtrack lets you use silence in a really powerful way.
Yes.
Like, in, I don't want to go back to Undertale too much, but...
We're gonna do it, fuck it.
I fucking love Undertale. Like... The very beginning of the Asgore fight, when the music cuts out and it's just like, human, it was nice to meet you. Really fucking intense music.
And then that is my favorite song in that game. That might be my favorite boss battle music. Like, they all have movements.
Mm.
You know, it's not just like, oh, this great theme that is over and then it repeats. It's right. Like, every boss fight has, like, three movements that are all distinct and, like, evolve with the progression of the battle. And it's like, that's fucking genius, man.
Oh, yeah.
Like, that's a thing that not enough games do.
That's a thing that, apparently there's only three games we're going to talk about, because that's the thing that the Gigas battle from Earthbound does wonderfully, too, is it starts with silence, and the movements are so long that, honestly... I caught myself wondering if it repeats at any point.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not just because there are movements, but honestly, it's because the movements don't... Like, there's no repetitions within them. It's just these weird sort of, like, what's the word I'm looking for? Apocalyptic-sounding
sure, sure.
noises.
Yeah.
And for a game that is so
bright and shiny all the time. It's the way that you were saying that, like, silence contrasts to a good soundtrack. Dissonance contrasts to a bright soundtrack. You know,
absolutely.
It's just like,
oh, yeah.
if you've got this so, like, positive, even in the moments of, like challenge soundtrack, and then all of a sudden you've just got noises and, like, creepy things happening.
Ambient stuff.
Yeah, it makes you feel like, you know, things pale in comparison to that.
I do want to give a shout out to, like, sound design distinctly from music, because obviously they're different things, but in video games they're pretty intrinsically related, and I think that's something that's often underserved as well. Is that a lot of these composers that we're talking about even have credits where they only did, like, stuff like sound design, like, you know, things like picking a UI noise that doesn't clash with all the music and stuff like that.
Picking a sound for when you walk into a wall and keep walking into that wall, and that's one of the things I most remember from playing Pokemon.
Oh, man.
I walk into walls sometimes just to hear that sound.
Like, my favorite, like, weird little just choice like that is the select sound in Pokemon, which I don't know if any of you watch our series SNS Plays, like, that's the end of the theme. Like, the press start is that select sound, just because I love it so goddamn much.
And, like, I love things like Zelda that use their sound design in the gameplay, too.
Yeah.
Like, every top-down Zelda game has a, like, repeatedly walk into the wall to find where it's hollow.
Mm-hmm.
If we're gonna talk about sound design in Zelda, and we really should, they made it impossible that anyone ever beats them at the "you found a thing" sound or the "you changed a thing" sound.
Yep, yeah.
Like, the walk into a room and the da 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 da. Like, I know what I'm doing now.
Incredibly,
you know,
iconic.
It's like, before I ever played a single other Zelda game, I started playing, and, like, I didn't need an NPC to fly in and tell me, "You're doing the right shit." The music did it. The little sound cues did it. I was like, "I'm onto something here. Let's go." And that's so much more satisfying. You know, it's the way they tell anyone who writes or directs to show, don't tell, when you're doing storytelling.
Yeah.
Those music cues are so much more satisfying than somebody I've never met running in and telling me a thing.
Or having, like, a fucking dot, like, a window.
Yeah, it's like, you did it! Like, I know, because the music told me. And that's so much fun.
It's actually funny because, like, anyone who's a regular viewer of the show will definitely know that, like, Super Mario World is my favorite Mario game. But it's actually one of the, like, I think we were talking once about, like, the debate of, like, what is the best Mario game.
Mm-hmm.
And while I still think Super Mario World is, like, the pinnacle Mario experience, I do think that probably the best piece of level design in, like, game history is Mario World 1-1. And that, like, opening sequence where, like, it teaches you how to play by, like, showing you what you can and can't do. And I think, like you're talking about with sound design, that's something that I think as games have become more evolved and more able to give you...
The two Goombas and the set of bricks and all?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
And then in Super Mario World, it asks you to, like, the way you learn things is you jump on those little things and a dialogue window comes up instead. And, like, I do think that, like, again, not to harp on this point, but the reason that so much of this is the stuff you talk about is because design choices that are made because of limitations are a lot of times... a lot more elegant than the ones that you come up with naturally that are the easy thing to do.
Yeah, because those, and that's something I noticed in playing Mario World. That's, in fact, the first criticism I have when I try and counter your belief that that's the best one, is I don't like dialogue boxes, and I've gotten stuck in those games because I skipped dialogue boxes. And, like, yeah, that's my fault. I should have read the dialogue box, but I don't want to, because I'm not playing text reader. I'm playing Mario. I want to jump on shit.
Right, it's not a platformer, it's not an RPG.
Right, I really wish I was there for your conversation about the best Mario game, because I just love talking about,
I think that was just in real life. Like,
yeah.
That wasn't a podcast.
Oh, well, that should be.
We could do that as a podcast.
Or just, like, a moment in one.
Fight for Mario Bros. 3 to the death.
I'm here to be the Mario hipster, because Super Mario Land 2 6 gold coins is so much fun.
Oh, man, that's a deep cut, bro.
That's the game that introduces Wario, and it's a game where you get to fight the three little pigs.
Shout out to Tanaka, because he did the sound design on that one, I think.
Yeah, he did.
So, we've been dancing around talking about Super Mario Bros. And The Legend of Zelda for a minute, so real quick, gonna give a shout out to who I think is probably, I think you could make the case for the most prolific video game sound composer, which is Koji Kondo.
Certainly
Kondo, excuse me.
Certainly the most prolific composer of iconic video game. Like, people have done more, but have people done more that everyone recognizes?
Right. Like,
I don't know that you could ever say yes.
I think, like, he's unquestionably written the two most recognizable pieces of video game music, which are the Super Mario Brothers theme. He's written the theme to every Super Mario Brothers game of, like, note, pretty much. But specifically the original theme.
Wa-da-wa-ba-da-bum-bum.
And also, he wrote the original Legend of Zelda theme, which is, I think, especially in, like, when you're looking at, like, early game design, is, like, one of the more impressive pieces that was created.
If I recall correctly, he also did specifically Ocarina.
He did, yeah.
Which, if you're jumping around just Legend of Zelda games as their music matters.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
He also did Link to the Past.
Yep.
I believe he also worked on Wind Waker. You know, so it's like, if there's an iconic piece of Zelda music that you know, he probably is.
I'm interested to see if Breath of the Wild tries to, like, make music part of the game in the way that, like, the mid to late 90s plus Wind Waker Zelda did.
Basically everything from Link's Awakening on.
Everything from Link's Awakening to Wind Waker. Twilight Princess, like, it was there sort of, but not really.
It's not a major theme.
It's not, like, an intrinsic part of the game. It's not, like, music isn't the way you, like, have power in the world in the way that it is in those games.
Yeah, Link's Awakening does that, yeah.
I mean, Link's Awakening's literally the entire thing is go to dungeons and collect magic instruments and then be able to make the fucking Windfish song. And I will say, like, I'm glad you brought up Ocarina of Time, because to the point that you're making, like, I think that's a huge reason why, like, that music, like, is so, like, you remember it, is because it,
it
builds the lore.
It builds the lore. It's like, it's such a cool statement from, like, Ocarina and Majora's in particular, is like, in Ocarina, music is your main source of power in the world. Like, you go and do these things, but you can only do it because you have this magic instrument.
Yeah.
And in Majora's Mask, which, like, largely deals with death and moving on in pain, it's like, that's how you help people, is you learn their song and tell their story. And that's really cool.
It's a beautiful message.
Same message is present in the Mother series does a lot of that too. Not just Earthbound, but finding melodies is the thing in Mother, and it's for a similar reason. It's to heal, damage. It's to end frustration and calm people down or remember things that you'd forgotten. It's the same kind of idea. The only reason you can have power is because it's facilitated by, if not directly given by, this music that you've come across, and it brings our attention to something that isn't just background. You know, it's essential. It ends up being essential.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think something that's really interesting about Zelda that you don't see in Koji's other work, specifically like the other Mario stuff that he's done, is that like each Mario game, like all Mario music feels cohesive, and I think the series that are tangentially related to Mario's music generally feel pretty cohesive. Like Yoshi music is Yoshi music, but it doesn't feel out of place.
Yeah.
Like it still has that Mario flavor to it. But I do feel like between each Mario game there is like a pretty distinct kind of like approach in some ways.
Zelda game?
No, Mario.
Okay.
And I think in Zelda games it feels a little bit less that way. I feel like all Zelda music has a little bit more cohesion. Do you guys agree with that at all? There's just something about the way that, like, it feels like a culture's music, if that makes sense. Like, it feels like this world's, like, a lot of the main themes feel like Hylian music to me,
I think that was true for Zelda games for the era in which Kondo was making most of them.
Right.
But I think with the 3D Zelda games, it became more distinct game to game. Like,
that's fair.
The Legend of Zelda and Link's Awakening and A Link to the Past all have very similar music sounds, but Ocarina and Majora's don't.
Yeah, they're very different.
I think those are, they still draw on it, obviously, a lot. But I don't think they're quite in the same vein. Although Mario does more, I don't want to say, like, ethnic spins, but kind of ethnic spins to its games, where, you know, like, if you're in a more watery area, it's got an island beat to the music. And
sure.
Mario doesn't just change, like, its approach so much as it sort of changes its, like, inspiration.
Yeah, that's fair.
I think that's what you were starting to get
at.
Pastoral sound, the hills and sort of sound to the Zelda music. It does all seem to stay within the same sort of landscape sound.
It feels very, like, classic adventure, you know, like the original Zelda theme, like, feels like, you know, like if the Lord of the Rings or something like this, like, had a sound, it would be like this. It's just this, like, epic slow crawl, you know, and then it builds into this dun 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 dun. You know, it's like, it feels like you're ready to go on a fucking adventure, you know, and I feel like a lot of the Mario music just, like, it just feels like Mario games. It feels, like, laid back. It's fun. Or when it's tense, it's because it's like, oh my god, you're gonna get crushed, you know, like.
And it does have a lot to do with the kinds of movement in the games, too. There's a lot of, like, punctuating, like, marching snares and stuff in the moving between sections in Zelda.
Very percussive.
Yeah, because you really can only do that. You know, you're on foot and you're moving on foot and you're either pushing forward or you're doing nothing. Whereas Mario, you can spend your time plodding around and bouncing between shit. And so, like, the little steel drum accents and the trumpets that have been added to later Mario games feel like they fit not just the place you're in, but the action your character is able to take.
The Kirby franchise is that, like, it's interesting how much the, like, meter and, like, amount that, like, notes are generally held and things like that really have a big part in, like, setting a musical palette. Mm-hmm. Like, Mario stuff decidedly has kind of a jazzier flow to it. Like, Legend of Zelda music is all, like
slower and
methodical.
Big unison trumpets.
Yeah, yes. And, like, big chords and big movements and, like, I think it's really interesting to see how much stuff like that, it really does set the stage, you know? It's like Kirby stuff being fast and everything. Like, you look at Kirby, and Kirby has that kind of look to him when he runs. You know, he looks like he's trucking along a little bit.
Looks
and
like he,
you know,
he runs like a kid. He runs like he's out of control, and maybe he'll fall at any given moment, you know? It's that sort of, like, reckless, just abandon to how fast can I possibly move? And it also works towards the audience, right? Like,
and that's
music,
Kirby.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The music in Kirby games feels, like, decidedly hyperactive.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, there's stuff everywhere, and there's sounds everywhere, and we're doing everything, and, like, what does this do? I don't know. Let's suck it up. What's the copy power? I don't like that one. Let's move on to the next one.
I feel like it has, like, an element of, like, innocence. Like, and not in the way that we were talking about, like, that level one town one where it's supposed to make you feel safe. It feels like that kind of, like, that boisterous energy that you associate with little kids in, like, summertime.
Yeah.
And, like, you know, like, and that's, I think of those kinds of things when I play old Nintendo games a lot.
Yeah, it's like exploratory innocence. It's like, I've never seen anything before, so let's take in everything around me, and, you know, it's, I don't know, it seems very consumed with distraction almost, you know?
Yeah. Alright, so we're back. Creative edits. Yeah, creative edits. So, to take it back to, like, some of these other composers we haven't really touched on too much, I think, specifically, I want to, like, give a shout-out to, Yasunori Mitsuda, who's the composer for Chrono Trigger, and Nobu Uematsu, who's the primary composer for the Final Fantasy series. I think both of those names are relevant when we're kind of talking about Legend of Zelda right now. And, like, that feeling of adventure and, you know, like, nailing that kind of fantasy setting.
Somebody made a point earlier about, like, it was Mike talking about the champion battle in Pokemon Red and Blue.
Mm.
I feel the same way about the battle theme from, I think it's Final Fantasy II in the US? The bum 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 bum. This is the, I'm getting into a fight now.
Yeah.
Time to wreck some shit or my shit's gonna get wrecked.
Yep.
I think it's Final Fantasy V that has that, like, is that, they make the joke about it in Scott Pilgrim?
Yeah.
They're like, doom, 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 doom. It's, like, fucking so, so good. He's so good at creating tension with movement,
mm-hmm.
you know?
And, like, and Mitsuda's battle theme for Chrono Trigger feels like that, but in a world designed by Toriyama, which is what Chrono Trigger is, which is so cool.
Yeah.
The bum 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 bum.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Driving bass lines. Great JRPG battle sounds.
Bass lines in video game music is very important. Bass line in all musics is important, but you can actually hear bass lines in video games musics, so.
You gotta contrast all of the violins that come with the pretty little pictures in JRPGs with driving bass lines when you're looking at something ugly. It's just the flip side, it's great.
I don't have too much else to say about those two specifically.
It's just like, they do what they do really well.
Yeah.
They're kind of the reason there's not much else to say about it is because
they just nail it.
Yeah, and Iomatsu in particular cornered the market.
Oh, yeah, he's done, like every Final Fantasy game.
There's a reason they have not replaced this guy, you know?
Yeah, dude does fucking work. he works on a lot of things too. Like Final Fantasy is just his most notable thing.
It's like, it's a great, not super intrusive score to like, Final Fantasy doesn't approach music in the way that like Zelda or Earthbound does, where it's like music is part of the story.
It's yeah,
like,
it's not.
It's like, it's a great movie score, but it's a very, I don't want to say forgettable.
It's just a different approach.
It's a different approach, yeah.
Yeah.
And I appreciate it for that. Same way, like, I remember liking it a lot, but I don't remember the Mass Effect soundtrack.
Yeah. There's no, like, theme that specifically sticks out to you. It's more ambiance. It's background music, but good background music is important.
Oh, absolutely.
And shout out to Final Fantasy II for, like, when we were talking about, like, memorable sound design, like, the da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Like, things like that are very, you know, pretty iconic. So,
oh, yeah.
Yeah.
To the point where people who haven't actually played Final Fantasy II perk up and hear that
yeah,
sound.
Yeah, automatically associated.
Wait a minute, I know that thing.
So before we wrap it up, I did want to talk a little bit about some more Tanaka's work. He was also, in addition to working on Mother and Earthbound, he also is responsible for the music for the Metroid franchise and Tetris.
Yeah, you're, like, the Tetris song that's now stuck in your head.
Yeah.
Tanaka wrote that.
So good, man.
This is the dancing couch this episode.
I mean, you might have seen the Silver Surfer video that starts with just a good 40 seconds of Pete and Ozzy dancing.
Just fucking sick rave parties.
So maybe not just this episode.
Yeah, I'm a dancey guy, man. I love music. What you can't do. But yeah, so I wanted to give shout-outs to Tanaka's work. Obviously, Tetris is just one of the more, like, memorable pieces of video game music. But I wanted to give a specific shout-out to Metroid for doing this kind of, like, what we've been talking about a lot of setting atmosphere. You probably heard me talk about this before, but, like, I write electronic music, and a lot of the stuff I do is chiptune, because I really appreciate that sound set. And Tanaka for Metroid... I have a VST, which if you don't know anything about electronic music, is essentially a synthesizer, that I use on my computer that's called Peach. And the entire purpose of it is to, like, emulate old NES and Game Boy, like, sounds. Mm-hmm. Like, and not specifically, like, the sounds or whatever, but, like, the way that the synthesizers were modified for each game.
Okay.
Right? And within those presets, like, there are, like, four different ones for Metroid, and it's really interesting when you listen to Metroid's music how he played with the way that, like, the attack on the notes and the way that, like, they reverberate to give it that, like, kind of, like, wide, almost, like, reverb-y kind of sound.
Yes.
It's like Metroid is another one of those games similar to The Legend of Zelda where, you know, they actually, like, had to put upgraded sound chips in the cartridges and stuff like that to make it capable of creating those sounds. And I think, like, that's so much of that atmosphere that you feel in Metroid of, like, being lost and of being, like, in this big, weird, open space that you can't quite navigate, you know? Like, it really nails that kind of, like, alien vibe.
Oh, yeah.
I think Metroid's music also does a good job of the same sort of thing we were complimenting Kirby's music for, where it sets... age well.
Yeah.
And, like, where Kirby sets the age of not just its audience, but also, like, Kirby is sort of this naive young character. I think with Metroid being about Samus, a bounty hunter, an adult on a mission, it's very, like, it's scary, and it's influenced by its environment, but just as much as got sort of a business-like flow to it. You know, it feels like somebody on a mission.
She feels
mission
confident.
To do her, yeah. There's it's not, like, exploratory so much as it is objective-oriented. It feels like, you know, I'm moving through this space because at the end of this, there's the thing I need to go get.
It feels calculated.
Yeah. It does. And not in a cold or distant sort of way, just in a sort of motivated by an end goal sort of way, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, there's a lot of, most video games of this era are sort of like greatness thrust upon you kind of things.
Yeah.
Where it's like, you are this guy, here's a sword. Whereas in this game, you're in Metroid. It's your job, you know, you are a bounty hunter.
I never thought about that. That's really interesting. Yeah, Samus is really unique in that way,
absolutely.
Especially among the Nintendo protagonists.
Yeah, for sure. And I think the music absolutely reflects that. It's not quite as unsure of itself. It's, you know, this is a new adventure for Samus, but being a bounty hunter isn't.
Right.
I'm doing my job in a new place. Let's get it done.
Yeah.
And I think it's reflected.
That's interesting, too.
I think the soundtrack also, like, I don't know, it's the only Nintendo soundtrack I would, like, describe as lonely.
I would push back just a littlest bit on N-Bits of Earthbound.
Right.
But N-Bits, yeah. Not the soundtrack.
The soundtrack and just the whole game of Metroid is like...
Isolation.
Isolation. It's a lonely game.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think, and the sound palette definitely reflects that, and I think, like, not only that, but it does a really good job of, like, to the point that you're making, right, that like, Samus is this accomplished bounty hunter, but, like, she's in this place where she's out of her element, or not necessarily out of her element, but it's a new place where she's not necessarily well-versed in the direction or whatever, and she's also had all of her tools taken from her.
Yep.
I think it's interesting how it does have that, like, driven kind of purposeful music, but also does give you that fear, that feeling of just, like, uncertainty, you know, where it's, like, it doesn't feel... lonely is a good word for it. It's not about fear, like, but it's about, like, that, like, I'm alone.
It's
like,
down to Samus.
Yeah.
It's not down to Samus and Samus's arm cannon. It's not down to Samus's and Samus's, you know, bombs or ice beam. It's Samus.
Right.
Can you navigate the space, you know, your experience, but can you do it here?
Yeah.
In this, like, new, horrible, lonely place where it's you.
I know we're talking about music, but I really appreciate the way the game uses the, like, negative space, and it's got the... Everything's on a black background.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because even for a game that spends nearly all of its time on the interior of things, it reminds you, oh, you're in space.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, there's this sprawling system of tunnels. In space.
Yeah.
Nobody's coming.
Yep. So I think we've hit a lot of the classics that we wanted to talk about. There was a couple modern games that we wanted to give a nod to. So Andy, you want to kick it off?
Yeah, I'll kick it off. Hotline Miami is a phenomenal game, and it does the, like, oh, we're going to use a sort of more traditional feeling, like, arcadey top-down shooter to explore deeper things than, like, the idea of violence in video games. And a big part of that is it's, like, really cool synthwave 80s-ish soundtrack that gets, like, deeper and darker and more ominous as you go on, and the game gets deeper and darker and more ominous. And I love it. Also, Hotline Miami is a big part of one of my favorite exercises in video games.
Okay.
It's, can you find a record that perfectly matches up as the soundtrack to a game? Start Hotline Miami and Kanye West's Yeezus at the same time, and you will not be disappointed.
You heard it here first. Did you invent that?
You heard it here only, I'm thinking.
Oh, no.
Is this your idea?
No, somebody on Reddit, like, suggested it.
Wow. Kudos to that guy on Reddit.
And it's, like, it's a fun game to play. It's, like, can you find a record that hits this game in particular?
I'm going to go play this game, because that sounds so up my alley.
Hotline Miami is a special one. I haven't played it either. I'm definitely, it's, like, one of those games that, like, you hear so much about, but I just... Never grabbed it. It was one of those, like, very early, like, indie hits.
Yeah.
Speaking of indie hits, I know this isn't our bullet list. It just occurred to me that I wanted to mention this game.
Sure.
Have either of you played the very simple arcade indie game for the 3DS, Woe Dave?
Yeah, I have. I played on Xbox.
Do you like Woe Dave?
I only played it once, but I had a lot of fun with it.
Okay, so Woe Dave is this really silly, stupid little game where these alien eggs keep popping up and you have to destroy them before they flood the game and you get hit by them 3 times and you die. You know, it's a very classic arcade game, but it does something really well that I'm always impressed when anyone can do this. It's a loop. It's an arcade loop of music that just changes a little bit as it gets harder, but it's pretty much 45 seconds of music. I play that game for an hour at a time, and I never, ever go, oh my god, I need to turn the music off.
That's a really tough thing.
I don't know how they managed that, but it's just fun. It's like, I feel like the little bits of increase they do when, like, the lava's rising and there's suddenly UFOs coming in, it's a little bit more intense, but it's the same theme, and I'm not sick of it yet.
That's good.
And making somebody not sick of the same 45-second clip after it's repeated for the 80th time is just, I'm impressed.
So the next example we had was, I wanted to give a particular shout-out to Shovel Knight, which, you know, we talked a little bit about today, and I think similar to its, you know, use of old-school aesthetic artistically with, like, real, true, fleshed-out pixel art and everything like that. It also makes really good use of a chiptune soundtrack that does a lot of the things we talked about here. It's very good at setting a theme. It's very good at taking influence from a game I meant to mention that I'm going to take an opportunity to give a shout-out to right now, which is Mega Man. Because Mega Man does a similar thing of having a good all the music, Mega Man music distinctly feels like Mega Man music because of the sound palette and because of its kind of, like, futuristic approach and modern influence from, like, rock, you know? Which is, like, obviously intrinsically a part of Mega Man if you know about its Japanese roots.
Shovel Knight does a good job of twisting that a little bit, where it still clearly takes a lot of that rock influence.
Yes.
But it does it with, like, medieval instruments.
Yeah.
And, like, my favorite thing that they did with that is, Shovel Knight's so, like, action-packed when you're playing it that you kind of don't totally get the music.
Yeah.
And that little dude strumming his lute in the market where you can go back and, like, bring him pieces of songs and listen to them. Like, that's not the music, but the fact that I can go do that is just so fun.
It's really nice. It's a nice touch, for sure.
I will occasionally, at the end of playing Shovel Knight for an hour or two, go back to that dude and just, like, click different songs and just enjoy it for a couple of seconds.
Because
they're distinct individual compositions, and they're good. They're good little pieces of music.
They really are. And I think the same can definitely be said for a lot of Mega Man stuff, so shout-outs to those games. They have a couple different composers, so that was why I didn't want to, like, compile a list for them. And then the last game I want to give a shout-out to is a game that we've talked about a lot on this show, because we love it.
Duck Game.
Duck Game is phenomenal.
And you play Duck Game?
I don't even know what a Duck Game is.
We're going to play it as soon as we're done. Duck Game is superbly fun. So Duck Game is just an excellent game in and of itself. It's a little Adult Swim game, like, they published it. It's awesome. It's like a classic 16-bit aesthetic.
They've made a couple pretty fun games.
They really have. Volgar the Viking's really good. Like, we've played a bunch of them on the show.
House of 1000 Dead Ninjas was a game that was up on their website for a little while that's just a fun sort of, you know, like, scroll down this clear giant house. And, that game was cool too. But anyway, Duck Game.
But Duck Game, personally speaking, I think the music is one of the best parts of Duck Game. And not because Duck Game isn't incredibly fun, but just because the music is, like, that fucking good, in my opinion. I, like, regularly listen to that soundtrack just when I'm just, like, driving around and stuff, because I like it so much.
Cool.
And it's, like, not one of those things where, like, it, like, necessarily enhances the gameplay. It doesn't really have anything to do with, like, Duck Game other than that it matches its aesthetic. And it's just really good fucking music. Good chip music.
That's awesome.
It's just kick ass.
That's awesome.
They're just, like, good jams. Like, like, the menu music and stuff is, like, very appropriate. It's, like, very, like, it's, like, very intense. But, like, just the regular music that you get while you're in a match loop, some of it's really fucking relaxing and chill as fuck.
Cool.
So, like, yeah, big ups to Duck Game soundtrack. Wow. If you haven't played Duck Game for yourself, like, you're missing out. Go try that game.
You got me excited.
One of the most fun games of 2015, I think, by, like, a lot.
And I think, at least Andy and I, and maybe you also, for the Tony Hawk series, want to just mention.
I forgot about that.
Some jukebox soundtracks,
which, I love a good jukebox soundtrack for things like sports games or, like, things that aren't trying to tell a story but be about the gameplay loop.
See, I think sometimes it works in story stuff too, because I just want to give big ups to Grand Theft Auto.
Oh, yeah.
Grand Theft Auto is
a remarkably curated soundtrack.
Yeah, and the radio portions that they add and everything are so good. Like,
yeah.
That entire package, I think, does a really big part of kind of, like, putting you in that, in Rockstar's America, for lack of a better term, you know?
I don't know Fallout well, but I am of the impression that Fallout carries this reputation.
Yeah, Bioshock does too, to a lesser degree, but yeah, both of those games make really good use of classic and then original old school music.
I think the two series, though, that we were talking before the podcast started, Tony Hawk and the Madden NFL franchise for me, not quite so much anymore. But when I was a kid, just got me into a bunch of, like, actually got me into bands that I did not know before I started playing those games. Did a good job of mixing up just, like, pop punk music and rap and pop music that you feel like would be played at a sporting event, you know? It just, it had the energy of a sports game, and I don't know, it just played as a group of songs together really well, but we're dancing around it. Tony Hawk, more than any.
Oh, yeah. I think, like, anybody our age that the listens NFL to
Street
rock music.
The soundtrack was also
really good. Oh, yeah, that was really good, too. That's true.
I really loved the Street series of games. Like, NBA Street was dope.
Being able to catch a football after jumping off of a wall and throwing off of a wall and doing shit off of a wall is just the most fun shit.
Awesome. The ability to have Peyton Manning, like, style jump off a wall to throw a deep bomb is so silly.
But wait, so... Tony Hawk. Yeah, I don't think that there's anybody our age who's into rock music that doesn't, like,
glean some of it
from one of the Tony Hawk games. Like, whether it's, like, Tony Hawk Pro Skater, like, one up until, like, American Wasteland is where, like, my expertise is with those games. Like, I fell off after Wasteland.
There's not much after Wasteland.
Yeah, after, after like, the PS2 generation, Tony Hawk games stopped really being relevant.
But, like, for me personally, I'm going to give my, like, penultimate shout-out to Jukebox to Tony Hawk's Underground soundtrack.
So I will be giving it to Underground 2 for similar reasons.
That's what I'll be giving mine to American Wasteland for similar reasons.
Those three games, I would say, have the best ones. The most thoughtful ones. The first four were great for a lot of reasons.
2 specifically has a couple great songs.
Absolutely.
Not quite as well curated.
And I think, you know, it just sort of worked well from the get-go because skating in and of itself is a cultural phenomenon that's very tied up in the music that goes with its scene. So it was great of them to recognize that before making the Tony Hawk games ago. You know, we can't have a skate game without the skate scene music. It's just not going to work. But when they got even more involved in it, it feels anyway like they got more involved in curating it when it came to the Underground games and American Wasteland.
Specifically American Wasteland,
which has design.
Yeah, because they seek out relevant pop punk bands and have them cover punk classics.
Because how many covers were there in that?
It's somewhere in the 8 to 10 range.
Yeah, it's like enough for like an EP.
Small album. Yeah, it could have been released as a split. You know, B-sides of the original bands and covers of the new ones.
That would be cool. Huge shout out, specifically in my opinion, anyway, to
the MCR cover of Astro's.
Yeah, he's so good.
It's so good.
Yeah, that's the best song from that batch for my money.
But even the Sonic Reducer cover is pretty decent, but the Ever Fallen in Love cover that Thursday does, I think, is really good on that. Like,
oh yeah.
Don't get me wrong, I'm with you. The MCR after.
Oh yeah, they're awesome.
But it really isn't weak at a point. The covers are fucking great.
Yeah, it's just I remember at the time being weirded out by the fact that I was more into the covers by MCR and Thursday than by Alkaline Trio and Green Day, who were two bands I actually liked.
The Network.
Yeah, the fucking not Green Day.
Lost, but we don't care.
Green Day with masks.
Yeah.
And, like, a keyboard player or something?
Have they ever copped to that? Because I remember when the Network were, like, trying to be a thing, they refused to acknowledge that it was that. Have they ever?
I don't know.
I feel like they just gave up.
Whatever, it's them. We all know. All
right. The Network is Green Day, you heard it here first.
The Jukebox soundtracks are great. I just want to give one more shout out to what I think we'll all agree is the greatest piece of music ever written for a video game. Sonic Adventure 2.
Oh my god, stop!
Run at the speed of sound. Got places to go, gotta follow my rainbow.
This is how they treat their guests. I want you to know.
This is how Andy treats me every day.
Fair enough, this is actually just how Andy treats me.
Follow me, set me free. Trust me and we will escape from the city. I'll make it through, prove it to you. Follow me!
My enjoyment on this show.
I know you're, like, not a fan of the song, but I really do love that moment.
I do too.
That's the only moment in that game I really love. It's just, like, it feels like I'm announcing this is a modern Sonic game.
I love the specifically the opening to it, where it's, like, he shoots out on the board, and it's just that little bass line that...
And then a truck fucking jumps up.
It's so good. So bad, but in the best way. In the best, like, early 2000s were terrible kind of way.
It's that. Maybe less the word best. No, I know. I'm not gonna alienate your viewers because I don't have that right as someone who's not actually a part of this show.
You
but,
can say what you want.
I think my...
You hate Mike, just still subscribe. We won't be here next week.
Yeah, no, I won't be back, so...
If you love Mike, subscribe and let us know, and then we'll force him to come back.
I'll come back if you guys like me, but you're about to not because, good God, do I hate Sonic soundtracks. So much.
We'll sit Mike and Thompson down to talk about how terrible Sonic is.
Yeah, please.
I like old Sonic games. Sonic soundtracks bother me so... Like, I think you have to be on, like, some serious amount of any upper to enjoy the amount of speed metal going on in, like, oh!
I'm not going to sit here and defend all of it.
Annoying.
I like the stuff that, specifically actually some of the, there's one composer who I really should have grabbed his name, but I'll fact check it for it, I'll do like an annotation on the screen or something. The guy, he worked on the Sonic games for the Genesis,
mm-hmm.
or not the Genesis, excuse me, the Game Gear. And he did totally new soundtracks to the Sonic port that they did, like, an 8-bit version of it.
Okay.
And his stuff specifically is really good. I think specifically, like, I like the Sonic theme. Like the da 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 da.
That I like. Because you notice that finger snap that you're doing here, that the tempo is...
And yeah. No, I know.
I don't have the cocaine in my household I would need to enjoy that Sonic at all.
I think if I were ever drowning, I would think of the Sonic drowning. Like,
yeah, it's a good one.
That's good. That actually is good.
Also, I will give big ups to Sonic for sound design things. Like, the spring sound is good.
Oh, yeah.
Ring sound is good.
I honestly think the contrast between how much I like the sound design and how much I don't like the music makes the music induce my rage even more.
Yeah.
Although the biggest piece of contrast that makes me hate Sonic music is the fact that
that not every piece of music is City Escape, I understand.
It's actually the fact that the newer, like, with vocals ridiculous ones are in Smash. So, like, if you've noticed, nearly every composer that we've mentioned on here has these awesome, big orchestrated arrangements in the Smash Brothers games. And I'm gonna listen to people go, yeah! And it's like, what am I doing? I was listening to, like, classic video game music played by a cello a minute ago. Why is this happening to me?
You know what's my favorite?
Because you're not following Sonic.
Do you know what's my favorite bad Sonic song in any of those games? It's Crush 40 is the band that does all those songs. And they did City Escape, and then they did the Sonic Heroes theme.
Sonic Heroes! Sonic Heroes! If we just sing the name of the game over and over, it's a song! Sonic Heroes!
We should do a study where we find out whether or not I play much better or much worse when I have to endure that song, because I'm sure I do one to make the game end sooner.
Crush 40! Shoutouts to Crush 40 for still being the Sonic band all these years later. Wait, did you guys see that Sonic anniversary stream that they did, or any of the highlights from it?
No.
Okay, I'm gonna show you a video afterwards that...
Is this done by the legendary Sonic social media team that's delightful and hilarious?
No, because they're good!
This is terrible?
Oh my god, dude. It's like literally the worst train wreck I've ever seen at what was supposed to be a professional event run by a company.
Are you sure? Because I watched you and Spaz react to the Sony conference.
No, because like at least that was like, it was a bad conference, but it was bad because it was boring, not because it wasn't a conference. You know? Like this was an event. I'm going to show you. There's a Jim Sterling, who I've talked about on the show a couple of times, a really great video games journalist and YouTuber. Did an excellent video where he just did selections of all the most, like, cringeworthy what-the-fuck-is-happening moments. My favorite part of it is, like, Crush 40's playing the Sonic Heroes theme, right? And he, like, the guy goes, he's singing it, he's like, alright, sing with me! And he goes and puts it to this mom, who is just like, I don't know the fucking words of this song. And he's just like, and she's just like, and he just holds it there, and she's just like, I don't know what you want me to do, bro. And he's just like, all right, you got it. And there's this kid who he goes to who just starts fucking screaming, like the most excited Sonic Heroes fan. Like, I didn't know these people exist. And he's just like, Sonic Heroes! It's so bad. It's like...
Like, is Crush 40, like, still the same people, or is it, like...
It's at least the same singer.
Do they just rotate in every...
I don't know. I feel like it...
Find, like, a guy who sounds like that.
300 Sonic. Years from now, the Sonic band will still be named Crush 40, whether or not it's this band.
So, Andy Brown, quick question. What do you think the percentage chance is that Sega hears our sweet renditions of those songs and calls us up to be the new Crush 40 singers?
I mean... I'm pretty sure it's already John Feldman.
Goldfinger does Sonic.
Goldfinger
jokes! The album
jokes.
I'm least likely to buy.
No,
forever.
Mike, he's a producer now. Blink-182 just... Fallout Boy.
This is not the purpose of this channel, but I would like to advise each and every one of you not to spend your money on Blink-182's California. That's all I've got.
PSAs. Alright, anyway.
That wraps it up.
Yeah, that wraps it up. We stopped talking about video game music a while ago. So!
Yeah, we started talking about Sonic music.
Yay! Oh, ha-cha-cha! If you guys like this video, please give it a like, share it with a friend, and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. If you guys want to get in contact with any of us, you know, you can hit us up in the comments below or hit either of us up on Twitter. We'll have a little annotation here like we normally do. Mike, Where can the people find you on the internet if they want to talk to you? Get your opinions on music.
If you want to throw my Twitter account into the description below, I'm happy to take the piece.
Oh, we're going to slide it in right over you right
we
now?
Will.
Yeah.
Just audio. Audio.
Is it here? Is it right here-ish right now?
It'll be like about here probably.
Somewhere there? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so any of the hate mail you'd like to direct my way about Sonic
Send Pete instead.
Send it to Pete. I don't want it. I don't want to hear about it.
You know what, man? The fans love me. It's you guys that give me shit. I have the support of the people. Hashtag leave Pete alone.
I think it's because all the shit we give you that the fans love you.
I know.
Like, you remember when Hillary Clinton's support like went up and during the Monica Lewinsky scandal? That's you. That's you. You're Hillary Clinton.
It's like you're
now the people don't
you're
love
the
oh god, controversy!
You're the endearing Ted Mosby or Ross Geller, who the fans love. For the rest of the show,
why does Ross, the largest friend,
simply not eat the other five?
Honestly, I am not gonna lie, I've had days where I've just considered doing that.
Eating the other just five? Consuming the other four and just I'll become the biggest fan as I ate
the largest friend here. Yeah, but I can. So anyway, yeah, if you enjoyed the video, if you enjoy our content, follow me. Set me free. Trust me, and we will escape from the city.
Oh my god, it doesn't get any better than that, kids. We'll see you next week.